Okay. Oops. There we go. Hey, welcome back, guys. I've just been recording without my mic. So, of course, now we are in the middle of the episode, at least for me. So, yeah, I'm trying to kill this Black Knight up here. And of course it's not going well, as this knight tends to be. I feel like I roll and it doesn't roll. I didn't roll there. Okay, well, we're just gonna do it without healing, I guess. I'm just gonna go for it. Okay. And look at that. We got the Black Knight Greatsword. Won't be using that. But probably has lore. Greatsword of the Black Knights who wander Lordran. Used to face chaos demons. The large motion that puts the weight of the bot. Puts the weight of the body into the attack reflects the great size of the adversaries long ago. This is another thing that From Software tends to do a lot. They kind of indicate with the weapons that you pick up what type of enemies they were being fought. It's present in Bloodborne as well. But yeah, so the Black Knights were fighting the Chaos Demons after Gwyn linked the fire. It's kind of an interesting thing. A lot of people associate the chaos with the fire and the fire fading and all that stuff, but I think there's a interesting timeline with all this stuff. Alright. See if he'll attack quick. He will. There's a big bowl up there. Big, like, I don't know what you would call it. Fang boar is the name of the item you get from there. I only see them in one other area of this game, so I don't know if that's an indication as to who they are. Ugh. I wish it wouldn't show you the items. Or if it has to show you items, that they should only put the items that you've got on there or something. Just because I know that, you know, most people, especially on a first playthrough, don't care about spoilers, but, you know, I mean, just even, oh my goodness, even just, like, knowing what kind of equipment you can get during the game and whatnot, even if you're not interested in lore. Especially like in the later games when, you know, there's maybe some characters or items that you didn't expect to get. It just kind of makes it whatever. What the? You know, that guy's gonna run after me. We need to get some damage going on this instrument here. Let's go through the criticals, I guess. Yeah, by the way, if you go fast enough and just run through this, you can prevent this from going down. That guy on the other side, if you kill him, he never responds, which is kind of unique, actually. Yeah, so now we have these alert skulls, which I think they're hinting at you should use here, but let's read them. Skull with meekly lingering souls. Throw to shatter and spread souls to attract certain types of enemies. Souls are a concentration of life, and the life starved hollows are lured by its power. Not effective for all enemies. Well, it is effective to this this fang boar. That wasn't really what I wanted. I wanted to throw it like in the fire here. I don't use these for anything, so I mean, oh my goodness. Surprisingly enough, you can backstab these guys, which is good because they are, it looks like they have a weakness in their armor there. Like in there, but oh, how lucky. Otherwise, when you hit them, they're very resistant. So, this is the Fang Boar helm. Let's take a look at it. What does it say? Severed head of the fully armored Fang Boar taken by the one who killed it as proof, just as the gods once did with the head of the ancient dragon. Can be worn on the head as a surprisingly sound piece of protective gear. So I guess the lore there is they're trying to tell you that the gods beat defeated the ancient dragons. But we knew that from the opening cinematic, really. So this guy comes and runs away from you, and he's supposed to be lured into, you know, here. I got my own wind up swing attack too, buddy. Wow, that was really weird. Straight sword. Oops. I thought I was on my Estus. Well, I won't need that again. Over here on a body is the mystery key. Now, they often say in this game, if you are stuck and you don't know where to go, just read the item description of things. This key is very helpful. Purpose of this key is unknown. What appears to be a basic prison cell key. I mean, that might mean that we should go back to the undead asylum. Not in this case. But that's what I would think if I were trying to read into this game for the first time. But no, it's just a prison cell right up here. This thing, like every time I'm in this room, I feel like there's an item that I always forget, and so I look, and then I always go, okay, yeah, there's no item here, remember that for next time, and all I remember is check for an item. Now we're right above these guys. So this is kind of an interesting section here. Again, this is not like, I don't know if you want to just say like this is lore or whatever, but here are the Boulder Knights. I just love the little details that they put into this world. I mean, we're going to learn a lot about Baldur and King Knight Rendel and all that stuff. But you see here, there's this Baldur Knight just sitting here observing this other corpse right here. He wasn't moving, he wasn't attacking, he wasn't doing whatever. And then you look at the corpse here, not the one I killed, but it's a... It's another Baldur Knight. And in fact, I don't know how many like corpses there are in this game, but like this is the only Baldur Knight corpse that I know of. What's even weirder is that he's got a knight shield. I mean, I guess not everything is intentional in this game, but so much is that it makes you want to read into it. Knight shields are hit by clerics, of course. This medium metal shield is elegantly carved and painted. Although it is thought to have been used by ancient knights of the nobility, its defense capabilities are similar to other shields. I mean, it's the one we saw Petrus using, so I don't know if it's specific to the nobility of Thirlwind or like ancient nobility and he looted off someone or something, but I don't know why that Baldur Knight has it and why the other Baldur Knight was like hovering over his fallen friend. But it's a cool little detail. Not always good with the upswing on that. Baldur Knights all use rapiers of some sort. I don't know if it's just a standard rapier or not, but yeah, there's a. There's another guy who uses a rapier that's actually hanging around where a lot of Baldur Knights are hanging around, so. Might not mean much, but. We shall see. Okay, and now we can get to the other side of this and punish this guy. For locking us out. And this is interesting. There's a corpse here that's just gotten past this and it has the basement key. If we look at that, basement key opens the narrow passage leading below at the far face of the Great Bridge in the Undeadburg. The lower Undeadburg is a treacherous place. Do not turn your back on the wily thieves or the wild dogs who serve the Capra Demon. So, I mean, again, this is one of those things. If you read this, you would. I guess if you assumed the Great Bridge was the bridge with the Hellkite Drake on it, then you would know where this goes. We found a locked door over there, and it is, in fact, what it's used for. It also tells you that there's thieves down in the lower Undeadburg, and if you turn your back, I mean, they'll slit your throat. So, we don't want to do that. And there's dogs down there. It's kind of interesting. They don't. Oops. They don't. Do this consistently throughout the entire game. There's some characters that help you with it, but it's interesting how this first part they kind of outline everything for you and like here's what to expect. Lower Undeadburg has dogs and thieves and the Capra Demon. Halberd, I'm pretty sure there's no lore on this. It's just a halberd. Yeah, I guess we'll try to come in through this way. Oops. That's it. I like the Baldur Knight shields. Oh. There we go, we got Titanite Shard. Let's read that while we have some time. Titanite shards are fragments of the legendary slabs. Titanite is etched into weapons to reinforce. That's funny, you'd think this guy would come for you, but this guy is the one that comes for you first. So let's go there's a lot of strange people in the Undead Parish here. So we have the Baldur Knights. Oh, come on. So these Baldur Knights here, we'll learn more about Baldur as we said. There's the Knights Berenique there. And above us, you know, we have a channeler from the Duke's Archives, which we can hear right there. He's particularly brutal. let's definitely get out of his way, but here, let me see if I can. Yeah, he can block it pretty well. Can I get two off? And he disappears and gives you a Titanite shard. We'll see more Knights Berenique and some other people associated with the Berenique Knights, like specific people. We get a Firekeeper soul here, and we can see here this is actually an undead that has a female figure as the kind of upper body garment, like all the women characters have. So Firekeepers are all women. I don't know if that's stated yet or not, but this one is a woman. And she's at an altar, and again we have the same statue that was down in Firelink Shrine. No, the same statue that was out there by the Sunlight Warrior Covenant. So it's kind of interesting. People have tried to depict what's on these things. As in the advent of Dark Souls 3, people have noted that this is a picture of a man holding an egg up. I don't know if that's worth reading, and it doesn't look like the eggs that are the egg in the third one. But anyway, if you don't know about that, you don't know about that. That's not relevant. But anyway, so what's interesting is that, we're here in this parish, and there seems to be a like an access, a direct access to Firelink Shrine. This is the lift that the merchant or the Crestfallen Warrior said it was broken. I don't really know why it's broken. I mean, it just seems to work if we come down it. But now, of course, it's full functioning, so if we go back up this way, this will come back down, etc. Which I guess we fixed it. We're engineers. We know how to do that by stepping on things.
Oh, I will teach you. Come
Okay.
again.
Anything more to say? Let's see if the undead merchant says anything, because we did something.
Don't you ever think to
Oh, I
forge
didn't
your
talk to him.
weapons?
Oh no,
You'd
this was
better find a smith box soon, unless you enjoy swinging about with blunt instruments. How did that silly sorcerer's apprentice end up? You know, the one always prattling on about Master Logan. He left for the undead burg but never came back. Serves him right. If even old Big Hat can't make it out there, what chance does he have? I hope he enjoys his new life as a hollow.
So he's talking about Griggs of Ventheim here, which we'll meet later. And he is mentioning Big Hat Logan, who I think is a really important character in this whole game. I mean, I guess you can believe what he believes or not. It's not necessarily, it's just my opinion that Logan's probably most, he's on the closest track to the truth. But I guess that's the undead merchant, or the Crestfallen, I don't know why I keep saying undead merchant, the Crestfallen Warrior, telling you to go look for him in the Undead Burg. He is in the lower Undead Burg, so we will be getting him soon.
I'm not up for chatting.
Okay, so that's the information. And of course, he's now reminded me, I might as well grab the bonfire while we're here. And let's level up while we're here. I'm just pretty much gonna go to 30 dex before I start touching anything else. So now that he's talking about Craig's and whatever, I was reminded of Rickard that we didn't check out here. He doesn't have a ton of lore or a ton of items or a ton of anything. He's not like the most interesting thing, so I always forget about him. But he's certainly worth talking to while we have the chance here. And we can pick up a few of these items, I suppose. I love this position of this hollow. He looks so glamorous. He's posing for a picture. This is the stupidest staircase in the whole thing. If you like walk the wrong way, you like fall, you like jump without whatever. It's kind of annoying. But anyway, there's this guy here who is dressed in similar garb to us. I guess it's not exactly the same.
Well, this is unusual. You haven't lost your head. And more importantly, you're free. How on earth? Well, I shouldn't pry. I'm Rickard of Vinheim. I was once an established smith, but look at me now. Can you believe it?
So he's from Vinheim, but he's a blacksmith. Which is interesting, because maybe it's in the further games, and maybe I'm just thinking of Melfia instead, but I don't think Vinheim really likes weapons and stuff, so I'm interested that they actually have a smith from there.
What is... Have you... Oh, no. Don't worry. I've no intention of escape. It's safe here. I can't bear the thought of going hollow out there. Although, I must admit, I've not much to occupy myself. How about this? I could forge your weapons, albeit with rather minimal tools. I'll show you what made me the best in Vinheim.
So he's a smith and he can do most of the stuff. I mean, I guess he, you know, he smiths your weapons to magic and enchanted and all that stuff, which is definitely in Vinheim's realm. But it just seems interesting to me that there's smiths in Vinheim when they're so heavily on magic. So let's read what his... We had the steel arrow, but let's look at the heavy steel arrow. Yeah, not much there. And then we have the sorcerer's catalyst. So nothing much there. Oh, interesting. Oh, he can. I guess he can do this while we're here. So I'm gonna start leveling that up. Oh. I don't have to. Well, I'm gonna have to come back for that in a second. Let's talk to him.
What is it? There's nothing to talk about. We're both cursed, undead. But what's there really to moan about?
Not everyone takes the undead curse a certain way. Some people hate it. You know, Crestfallen Warrior mentions that he'd rather. He's like, maybe going hollow would be the best thing for everyone. But he likes just being hollow in this cell because he doesn't want to be close to going hollow. Looks like he's reading a book.
What is
that's
enough?
He doesn't
both
say much of anything. Well,
Goodbye, then.
Let me go
keep
get...
That. You really help.
I gotta go get these extra 100 souls. Silly. There we go. And while I'm out here, I might as well grab the stuff. Yes, Doc. Which is a... I mean, this might be what the Baldur Knights have, I don't know. Largest of the thrusting swords can pierce an Arbor Knight. The blade is also sharp. The stocks are good for dex builds as well. Huh. Many is a transient curse, which will help us in the future. Oh, we didn't read the Firekeeper's soul. Might as well read that now. Each Firekeeper is a corporeal manifestation of her bonfire, and a draw for the humanity which is offered to her. Her soul is gnawed by infinite humanity and can boost the power of precious Estus flasks. It can be used to gain humanity and restore HP at the cost of losing the Firekeeper's soul to reinforce the Estus flasks. So this is where we learn a lot more about the Firekeepers. They are the bonfire, but in body form. And they draw the humanity when it's offered to the bonfire or her. But her soul is infinite humanity. And because of that, you can use the Firekeeper souls to boost the powers of Essence Flask with a Firekeeper, I guess, is what they're trying to say. It's a little bit probably translated, but I don't know, just interesting to learn more about that. I realize, transient curses. Limb of the victim of a curse. Temporary curse allows engagement with ghosts. The only way to fight back against ghosts who are cursed beings is to become cursed oneself. The safest method, however dreadful, is to cut off the arm of the dead. So yeah, one of the interesting things about the transient curse is that it is a limb of an undead that was cursed. And so we're literally just carrying around limbs. In order to interact with curses. There's other ways to interact with cursed ghosts.
Ah, what weapons have you brought?
Alright, well, let's do the Uchi Katana at a +2.
What is it? There's nothing to talk. We're both cursed.
Okay. He still doesn't like me.
Goodbye, then. Keep your head on him. You really helped break the monotony.
I won't be back for a long time, dude. And because we have three humanity. I want to keep those. Let's just homeward bone. I'm gonna suicide, or I guess not suicide, but I'm gonna go get this another Firekeeper soul out here. This is an interesting thing for me because so this is a new Londo, of course. Which has been flooded, and obviously we'll get into all the details about New Londo here in a bit. But it looks like, you know, similar to the Firelink Shrine. They had like a little area here, and we can take a look in more detail once we're a little bit more powered up. But we had an area over there where there's probably a Firekeeper. Like, it seems like each area has their own Firekeeper or whatnot. So, yeah. There's lots of Firekeepers. Speaking of which, we have two. Oh, let's read the other one, because I think they're all. I don't know if they all say something different. No, one says something different, but I'm going to look at all of them anyway. Okay, so now we are giving her the two Firekeeper souls that we found, and now we have an Estus Flask +2, as you see there. She cannot speak, which is interesting. It seems like all Firekeepers have a deformity of some sort. That might be part of it.
Oh, have you seen that terribly morose lass?
Yes.
The Firekeeper. She's stuck keeping that bonfire lit. Sad, really. She's mute and bound to this forsaken place. They probably cut her tongue out back in her village so that she'd never say any god's name in vain. How do these martyrs keep chugging along? I'd peter out in an instant.
Yeah, so, I mean, that kind of gives us the clue why we didn't have to light the bonfire when we came here. She is directly below it, and she's keeping it lit. And if she were to leave, it probably would go out. And he also said that she had a tongue cut out, which is interesting because, I mean, all firekeepers have some deformity, as I said. But this one was inflicted upon her like she was maybe made a firekeeper. Like you can make a firekeeper. It's not like a race or something. And they did it so she wouldn't take any god's name in vain. Seems like an interesting culture that would be so nervous about something like that that they, in order to, you know, if they're going to make her a firekeeper, they need to make sure she'll never take a god's name in vain. Could be Thurland. Could be, I don't know. We'll have to see where she comes from.
Hmm? What now?
I'm not up for...
Okay. Let's see if Petrus has anything going on up here. Can't remember what all these triggers are. I didn't properly talk
to him. Miracles? Very well. I can surely tell. Come again.
Okay. And I'm probably just gonna go up here and end in the undead parish or whatever before we take on the gargoyles. But I want to show you some stuff up here. This is the first time we have access to this area up here. So we'll kind of come down here. There's an item we can get up here. Oh, really? That roll or that jump for a long time. I used to try to jump it each time, thinking that was the only way to do it until I learned that rolling is way easier. I guess you just gotta get the right angle. So let's try it again. I always forget this item there because, of course, I always get it when I come and get this item here. You can go all the way up to the crow's nest, and we'll definitely be doing that later. But this is an item that we'll need for going up to the crow's nest. Well, kind of. Not to go up there, but it certainly will apply. So yeah, now we have the undead asylum floor to west key. We have the east key earlier. Now let's just see if it says anything interesting. Key to the iron bars on the west side of the asylum. But even if a hero found a key in Lordran to liberate this prison, would he have the means or the heart to ever come back? That's an interesting little thing. It's kind of telling you you can go back to the end of the asylum. This is where Petrus is, down there. And I guess there's some cool light shining in there. But yeah, you gotta get this. And yeah, let's go meet one of my favorite characters. As we go to the Undead Parish. It is interesting that they have a, you know, like a direct access to Firelink Shrine from this parish up here, this church. Not sure, you know, it's hugely significant, but, you know, it just makes you think about the world design and, you know, how this world played out. I mean, I think one thing that's really interesting is, of course, that, there's this, you know, other area over here next to the parish, through this corridor down here. Oh great, I need more crossbows. But we have this huge parish right here, right? It's connected directly to Firelink Shrine and kind of towers over all of the Undeadburg, or at least what's known as the Undeadburg today. But then over through this kind of walkway here, these pillars, I mean, there's this other building here that is definitely some sort of shrine or parish or altar or something. I mean, it makes me feel like this used to be the Undead Parish before they moved to bigger and better things. Like, they grew the organization quite big. And we hear a sound. I realize there's two characters here that one could claim to be your favorite. Well, here I'm going to reverse hollowing. I have the humanity to spare. And since we'll be back to this many times, I'm just going to kindle it once to go up to 10. Because we'll be using this a lot. But yeah, I meant Andre, the noise we're hearing, but of course one could find this little onion man as well to be their favorite. Let's talk to him. I mean, he's sitting in front of this crazy place here. I like how they use this cover so you can't really even see inside all that much. Oh, there you go. You can see the enemies in there.
Oh, forgive me. I was absorbed in thought. I am Siegmeier of Katarina. Quite honestly, I've run flat up against a wall, or a gate, I should say. The thing just won't budge, no matter how long I wait. And oh, have I waited. So here I sit, in quite a pickle, weighing my options, so to speak.
I don't get why he laughs at that, because I don't know. It looks like he's fat with this armor, but I mean, it's been stated and shown that he is just a normal sized man inside this kind of billowy armor. But he makes so many jokes about being fat. I don't know. I guess it's just part of the charm.
Still closed. Still closed.
So anyway, I think we'll probably want to open this for him or help him or whatever. And of course we will do that. But there's a big area here. Fortress. Trying to see if you can take a look on top. Yeah, you can't really see anything. But yeah, it's me, my actual favorite character, Andre. Well, the one I meant. He's not necessarily my favorite, but he's the one I meant when I said one of my favorites.
Well, you must be a new arrival. I'm Andre of Astora. If you require smithing, then speak to me.
Well, we've already met a blacksmith, so we know all about it. Let's learn a gesture from him. Hurrah! Bully, bully. Let's see what he's got. Titanite shards, which is great. He sells infinite ones of them for pretty cheap. So we'll be able to get up to plus 5 if we have enough souls, which we will soon. He sells a number of key items that are interesting. The crest of Artorias, and then these weapon, armor, and repair boxes. I think we read these. Tools, etched titanite, and weapons, and armor, and the repair box. Oh, interesting. I thought he had the bottom box, bottomless box. I should have bought that before I killed the undead merchant, I guess. I mean, I don't need it, but it's just nice. And then the crest of Artorias. This crest opens a door in the Darkroot Garden, sealed by an ancient magic. The door leads to the grave of Sir Artorias, the Abysswalker. Many adventurers have left for the grave, but none have returned, for they make easy prey for local bandits. With such dangers, the crest can do more harm than good in the hands of the uninitiated. So, Artorias is definitely someone to keep an eye on. He's called the Abysswalker. Part of his thing that we're going to learn is that he has a lot of tales about him. We're going to learn about those tales, and maybe we'll even get to find out the truth of those tales. But anyway, there's his grave in the Darkroot Garden. We're going to definitely go there. Straight sword. Let's see if any of these have any particular lore. Caestus. Witch shields are lighter. Same. Tower kite shield. Decorated with a tower, the symbol of protection. Decorated by an ancient blue caduceus. And arrows have no lore on them ever. Okay, let's talk to him, see what he has to say.
Most weapons and armor are mighty sturdy indeed, but every hunk of metal has its breaking point. If you notice durability running low, it's time to repair. You can ask a blacksmith like myself, or do it on your own with a grindstone. The nice thing about weapons, they never betray you. So pay them a little respect, eh?
My Uchi Katana is going right into his face. It's interesting, he says use a grindstone. I mean, that was how you repaired items in Demon Souls. They don't have grindstones here. You could be talking about the box, or you could be talking about repair powder as a grindstone or something, but...
There are two types of weapon forging. There's reinforcement, and there's ascension. Reinforcement is simple. It strengthens the weapon and nothing more. A simple task for any blacksmith. Hell, you could even do it yourself with a smith box. But ascension's a finer art. It alters a weapon's properties. Ascension is the territory of we blacksmiths. A smith box just won't do the trick. Start out with reinforcement. When that loses its charm, you can consider ascension. As you've noticed, this land is flush with the mad and wicked. You won't make it through the night without employing my services.
Strengthening your weapon is more valuable than leveling up in a lot of cases. I mean, point for point. I mean, you can go up to, you know, reasonably, you can go up to 40 or 50 on each stat that you have, but, I mean, weapons only go up to 15 max, I mean, 10 usually. So, I mean, per point in weapons is going to be, you know, more valuable than per point in a stat, I think. You know, I mean, early on in the game, it definitely pays to level up. I think that's what he's saying. And, yeah, Ascension is like in the modify screen, whereas Reinforce is just the normal, like, leveling up. 1+1+2+3 modify makes it a bunch of different things. Let's see what else he's saying.
You can forge armor just like you do weapons. Forging armor is even easier than forging weapons. Whether you forge weapons or armor first? Well, that's up to you. But nobody wants to see you go hollow. So whatever you do, you'd better do it well.
Andre's the only NPC besides, you know, the primordial serpents, but it's not the same thing with them. He's the only one whose lips move when he talks. It's really weird. Kind of makes, you know, you think, is it an oversight again, or is there a plan? I mean, I think that there definitely is an attempt in this game to give the delivery of the lines and whatever a dreamlike quality. I mean, apparently they're not even in our worlds, like Solera was saying. They could be just phasing in and out. So, but this guy's talking with his lips, and he's got a badass ponytail.
You can forge armor. Forging armor. Whether you forge, but nope, so whatever.
I didn't forge my armor, by the way. Does he not say anything else? Okay.
But nope, so...
I thought he definitely had other things to say.
I'll be seeing you then. Be careful.
Okay, so I think that's going to be it for this. Now that we've kind of finished the upper undead burg, we are probably going to go... I might take a detour at the Darkroot Garden and just kind of, like, you know, look around there and talk a little bit about the Darkroot Garden, which is really cool, before I go and kill the kind of main boss of this area. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.